Hello everybody, welcome to Elite Wine TV.
Hello everybody, welcome to Elite Wine TV. Everybody, welcome to Elite Wine TV. I'm your host, Mark Fusco, here with another edition of the show. We got the new camera going. It should be looking good. I can see myself on the thing. The label shouldn't be washed out. I did the white balance. I did the exposure. So here's a couple things real quick. Forgot to start that though. All right, so we got the new camera, and it looks like I need to sit in just a little bit. We got the new camera. It's a Canon Vixia HF M500. There'll be a link below to my Amazon link, so you can, well, it might be sold out by now, because it looked like they only had one left. But you can buy it if you'd like, and I get a couple ducats out of that. Anyway, so I bought that. Then I got these cards. I'll put links below for this. I actually got a third one. I haven't used it yet. I'm not really sure how I use the black card, but I got these from actually an art supply place, and they're free. And I got the big ones, and I got a little bit smaller ones, and a little bit smaller ones, and free shipping, everything free. This sets your white balance, which means the color of the thing. Maybe a little bit later I'll show you the difference once I turn this chandelier on. You'll see how I become all red. And then you've got this one that sets up your exposure, and pretty sure everything's good. The camera's set on manual, so it's not doing anything auto-wise. All right, so I'm real excited about that, and I did some testing earlier today. I'm using the SP level of recording. Now that's I think it's 7 megabits per second. For all you techies, it goes up to like, I don't know, 20 or 25 with the MXP, and of course the files become really big. You only get about 4. Need to make sure I'm looking there. I don't have like a nice little red light on the camera anymore. I do on the, I see the little red dot above my head, but I really wish I had the little red dot on the front of the camera. Anyway, enough of that. So. But you use the really, really high-end thing, and you get you can use less of your storage of your storage card. I got a 16 gigabyte card in the camera, and so yeah. Anyway, I'm just, can you tell I'm excited about getting a new toy? And I've been wanting this camera really since it came out, and it was the successor to the Vixia HF M4 series, the 400, the 40, and the 42, I think it was. And this is the, and I have the 500, which is the low end. Then you have the 50 and the 52. And the big difference between those two and this is that those two have Wi-Fi, where I could have the camera connected to the computer on Wi-Fi and then transfer the files that way. That end, those cameras also have some internal memory. I just look at it this way. I'd rather have no internal memory and decide how much I want to put in there. So anyway, so we got that. I'll be getting a remote Monday. The place that had the remote forever, and I finally ordered it, they oversold it. So I sent an email going, hey man, are you gonna, you know, I haven't gotten the email that you've shipped it. So, and everybody else was sold out. Probably because this camera went on sale for Black Friday, and you know, the price dropped tremendously. So it's probably why they ran out of that. So if I have a replacement one, supposedly it works. It looks just like it. All right, so let's get into some wine. Now that I've spent 3.5 minutes yabbering about this, we're gonna spend a few more minutes yabbering about this wine. Okay, so I guess I've been waiting to do this wine. I've been wanting to do it for a long time. I really want to do like a Skype interview with Sebastian, but I haven't really contacted him on it, and we never said that I was gonna do it. He just gave me the wine, but let me give you the backstory on this. So for those of you who have been following me for at least a year or longer, you know that I went to Bordeaux. I went to France in September of 2011. And it was a wonderful trip and a great time. And of course, you've been seeing the posts that I've been doing. In my travel, my train ride from Paris to Bordeaux, I tweeted that I was, you know, passing through the city, through the town of Tours in the Loire Valley. I don't think I'd gotten there quite yet, but I was about to. And Sebastian from this winery, from this chateau, sent me a tweet saying, "Hey, you should stop by." Well, unfortunately, I couldn't really stop by because I didn't really have a, you know, I was on my way to Bordeaux. I really couldn't do all my, you know, lug all my luggage around, and or I wouldn't didn't really expect them to like be my, you know, be my chauffeur and all that. So I said, you know, it'd be great, but you know, I'm not going to be able to make it, but I will be back in Paris, you know, a few days later. And they said, well, that'd be awesome. We'll go ahead and meet up. So I get back to Paris, and Sebastian and his, I hate to say, I don't know if they're still together, but his girlfriend, fiance, I don't know if they weren't married at the time, Darcy, they live in Paris for much of the year. And so we met up in Paris, and they took me out to dinner. At the same day, the same dinner, or the same night, I also met up with a cousin and her husband that we didn't know lived in Paris until about 4 months before my trip. So I ended up meeting with her, and which was awesome. So I got to meet family in Europe. So we all met together, and we had some drinks together, and then Sebastian, Darcy, and I had dinner, actually at the place where we had we started up with some drinks, and they brought me two wines. Now we're gonna do the first wine. This is their non-vintage Chateau du Petit Thouars Rosé. It's a non-vintage, and this is this area of, or this is from the Touraine region of France, AOC, and it's part of, the Touraine region is a larger area of the Loire Valley, and one of the more well-known parts of the terrain is Chinon, which Chinon is, if I remember the map, not very far east, like maybe like 10 miles east of this area. And Chinon, of course, is known for Cabernet Franc, which, you know, I really like. So this this wine comes from that area, and it's a Cabernet Franc Rosé. It's non-vintage, though they do make some vintage versions of this. And what was interesting about doing my research, and they had told me some of the story when I was there, the family, du Petit Thouars, their ancestors definitely have a lot of, or decorated with in the military and their diplomatic parts for France. They got into wine. They planted and, well, say, why don't we just read this, undertaking many projects in the new millennium, so in the 1900s. Latest generation of the family show how true they are to their ancestors. So Yves and Marguerite planted and developed from scratch a new vineyard in 1975 and took over the family patrimony, particularly the elegant castle built in typical architectural style of Touraine octagonal tower. Tufo's stone. That didn't really sound really like a sentence, did it? But that's how it's, I probably didn't read it in a good way. Anyway, so they've been involved in this for a while, and in 75 they basically replanted everything. So they've got a long history with in France. So I'm just still floored that I was given wine by people, okay, that had never met me. I didn't have anything. I hadn't set up anything in advance with them. I just was going through and they tweeted me. I'm still floored by it. So got the wine. They also gave me another wine, which we'll be doing, which I think I'm going to be doing as one of my Christmas wines. So that's going to be awesome. And we'll get to that when we get to it, okay? So this wine, I don't know if it's available in the United States. I brought it from France. This is, you know, totally, if you were in France, this is exactly, You know, the label is, the back label is all in French. Okay, if you can see some of that. So it's, I don't know if it, I don't know if it gets imported here or not. The town, the area that they're in is Saint-Germain-sur-Vienne. So it's, which is, like I said, a little bit west of Chinon. Anyway, when I looked up on the website, it translates to about $10 US. So it's a value wine, and I cannot wait to try it. And let's check it out. Just finished watching the Spurs-Miami Heat game, and I can't believe that Miami really just kind of cruised through the whole game and almost let us win. So it was pretty exciting. I was actually expecting to start this about, I don't know, halfway into the third quarter, because I figured Miami was just going to roll and go up by 20, and I was just going to start this. But watch till the end. It was exciting. Anyway, Sebastian and your family, cheers to you. Now, granted, ooh, another use for this. I have something white, pure white, or almost pure white. Okay, so this wine is clear. However, it does have some sediment in it, which I had noticed earlier. So it is aging. Now, I don't know exactly how old this particular wine is. I don't know when the, you know, there's no vintage, so there could be a couple different vintages going on here. But there is a little bit of sediment in the wine, which isn't bad. It's okay. But it's, you know, it's a rosé, but it has a little bit of orange tint to it. Okay. It's, and again, for those of you that are not familiar with anything other than red or white, just because it's pink doesn't mean it's sweet. Okay, so I get it, you know, a little strange. At first I got a little vegetal component out of it, but I also got like a little bit of like rubber band. So kind of interesting. Rubber band or like tire shop, rubber, okay? And that is the predominant aroma coming off of this. I don't really get anything else. I mean, I'm just gonna say I get a little bit of red fruit, but you know, you definitely get that tire shop. Yeah, really the tire shop type of smell out of it. Which I find interesting, but I do wish there was a little bit more than just that coming off the nose. But I had just opened this maybe about 10 minutes ago, 10, maybe 15 minutes ago. I opened it with like 2 minutes left in the game. Just kind of hoping it will blow off a little bit and it'll develop a little bit more in the glass. I don't really get anything else but floral or wood. There's a little bit, almost like a pasta type of, almost bakery type of smell coming out of it now. So kind of like a cooked pasta smell. Let's just go ahead and just dive into it. It's got a nice tartness to it, okay? So this is one of the really cool things about wine and our senses. I smell a lot of that tire and that tire shop and auto, almost like repair shop smell. Not really any oil and petrol, but you get that type of smell out of it. Not at all on the palate, okay? But there's definitely a nice tartness to it. Like I said, this is not a sweet wine. Almost like a little bit of watermelon. Maybe a hint of vegetal to it, but It's, and what I mean by watermelon is kind of that watermelon candy type of thing. So you get the flavor, not like, not like the sensation of eating a watermelon, but pretty high in the acid, and it was only 12% alcohol, so not very high in alcohol. I don't really feel the alcohol at all, and you also get somewhat of a grapefruit. That's what it is. It kind of a, these are something else citrusy, but more of a grapefruit flavor to it. So you got a little bit, had a little bit of watermelon candy, but grapefruit to it. I really like this. You know, so basically, it's a $10 bottle of wine that if you chill it a little bit, because I bet you it would taste a lot better if I chilled it. So, which as everybody knows, I don't chill my stuff. Normally, I don't. Sparkling, I do. But It's a refreshing, if you chill it a little bit, get it, you know, it would be really great. This is definitely a great summer wine. You can definitely do this also chilled in the holidays, and that's kind of why I wanted to go ahead and do this wine, because I didn't do a rosé for Thanksgiving. And I really wanted to do this one, but I was kind of, maybe I not, you know, but I was like, you know what, I'm probably never going to get it set up with them. And I really want to get these wines, you know? It's pretty good. I'll give it like an 85. I think it's well-made wine. I think it's well-balanced. I think it's a good value. It's a good value wine if you do get it in the States. It's a recommend. Definitely a recommend. I'll bump it to 86. Yeah, I like it. I think you should try it. All right. So again, hit the links below. Okay, for the camera, and I'll have links for these. Okay. We're about to go into the next wine, but don't forget to come to the website and leave comments below. Try and do all the stuff I do at the end of the show earlier, so that maybe I get some more traction on the website. You know, come by, leave some comments, and I've also got, you know, you can friend me up, and you've got the donate button, value for value type of thing here. You like what you see? Drop a couple ducats into the little tip jar. Actually, that's what I have on Vimeo. I have the tip jar enabled, but you set that up and buy him some more wine. So let's move on to the next wine. All right, now we're back with the next wine. Now, this is going to be one of those rare times I've had this wine already. This was one of the wines I got off of a woot.wine sale or whatever, you know, whatever, you know, woot. And it was a five bottle deal. Now, I've had a few, you know, times where we're going to have something to eat or I want to have some wine, and I don't really have any other wine but review wine in the house typically, you know, like, you know, some people may think that I've got, you know, a wine cooler, a wine cellar, you know, a wine refrigerator. In fact, I don't. I have a wine rack over here, and it has, you know, a decent amount of wines in it right now. But the majority of the wine that's in that is wine I buy for review, not to just drink in between recordings. So pretty much the wines that I drink are the ones I review, and then I drink them later. And then, you know, if I don't do a review, I'm kind of like, I need some wine. Anyway, but I've already had, actually, I think I've only had one of the bottles so far. One, two, three, four. Yeah, I've only had one of the bottles so far. I haven't had any more. I was going to open up one of the bottles again, but I didn't want to get through my whole supply and then not review it. Anyway, so this is the 2007 Striped Bass, or Striped Bass, as you can see on the label here. Okay, it is a bass in the shape of a bass viol, so a double bass. This is a Napa Valley red blend. Now, this is produced by the Truchard Vineyards out of Napa. Now, they are in the Carneros area of Napa Valley. Carneros is one of those areas that's one of those AVAs in the United States that straddles more than one area. Now, you have a Carneros in Sonoma, and you have Carneros in Napa Valley. These guys are in Napa Valley. I bought this off of Woot. It was a five bottle offer for $60, $59.99 plus $5 shipping. I love Woot. I don't buy as much as I used to off of Woot, just because I try to like buy local stuff. And the thing with Woot is that you're buying lots of bottles. I don't know why I have that. You're buying lots of bottles instead of like one or two. So since I'm trying to only buy stuff I review and not just buy to drink, I tend to not go to Woot a whole lot. But this one caught my eye because, well, I'm not a fisherman, but I'm a musician. So I was like, I've got to get this. So let me kind of read the little thing. And you had to go to stripedbasswines.com to get this. If you go to the Truchard winery website, you will not find this anywhere on there. And I'll explain that in a little bit. So the ISB, the International Society of Bassists, spawned an idea of a wine to support their eternal quest for perfection in music, food, and wine. Truchard Vineyards have fine-tuned this well-composed Zinfandel with harmonious chords of jam and berry, which sustain an upbeat and vibrant timbre throughout the performance. Warning, always keep your instrument tuned. Never attempt to tune a fish. Ba-dum-bum-tsh. Okay. So this is this is mostly Zinfandel. Now, on the Woot, I went ahead and went back to Woot to kind of look at this stuff, because they do keep the what they sell around as far as, you know, the page. The winemaker got involved in the conversation, which is awesome. It's Anthony Truchard, and he explains that it's 85% Zin and about and 15% Cabernet Sauvignon. So they technically could call it a Zin, but they decided to call it a blend. They say that it's aged in French and American oak, roughly half and half, with 30% being new. And then there was something else. Oh, well, and then for the geeks, it's 0.8 grams of residual sugar. And then somebody had asked, or somebody, I guess, made a comment that it was just some cheap wine they were just trying to get rid of. But what Anthony had said was that it was a wine that they made to have some fun with a distributor that they were using. They stopped using this distributor, and they had extras. They had extras, and they wanted to, you know, at least to sell them. So they went through Woot, which Woot's a great way to get some wine sent, you know, sold. By the way, so since it was $60 for five bottles, it's like $12 a bottle. Anyway, and then he also talks about how this wine would be more like an old world Primitivo, or done in the style of Zins in the 80s and 90s before Zinfandel became like this really big. Big wine, so it's not your typical like in your face Zin, okay. Anyway, so that's kind of a little bit about that off of Woot. I don't need that, and I don't need that, and we're on. I'm on the pages for the next wine. The Truchard Vineyards has been around for quite a while. Just like a lot of vineyards in California, they started off as grape growers. They, you know, as farmers, they would sell their grapes, and then they started making some wine. So, and they have quite a few wines that they make. They're one of the most diverse wineries in Napa for the amount of varieties that they actually grow. So, I would definitely love to check them out one day. All right, so let's get my handy dandy white card here, and let's take a look. Now, it's kind of a, you know, it's a little cloudy. Well, maybe it's just, I wouldn't say it's cloudy. I can see my hand through it, and it's actually clear. But when I look through it on here, I guess the texture of the card makes it look a little cloudy. Not a whole lot of staining on the glass. And it's not a deep, dark color. It's a little bit light, so I mean, you expect Zins to be really deep. It does get to a watery edge, but it's not much. Okay, I mean, it's not like it gets to water really quick. It's just like a very thin, but it's definitely more of a. We're not supposed to use brick because brick can be a lot of different colors, but it's red. Okay, almost reddish brown. I remember liking this before, so this is going to get a good review, just so you know. But I do get. You know, I get the, it's like that dark fruit pie aspect, okay, with little hints of cocoa. I mean, really kind of sitting back here, I'm getting that cocoa type of aroma, which is kind of neat. And that powdery cocoa, almost like, you know, Nesquik, you know, chocolate milk. Oh, I love that stuff. But definitely the dark berries, a little bit of creaminess to it. You know, and what I mean by pie, I always, when I say that pie aspect, you have to assume you're getting whipped cream on it, okay? Or Cool Whip or something like that. But there, you know, there's a jamminess to it too. Bit of vanilla. So that's gonna also come through. That's where you're getting your American oak. Hi, Sarah G. I don't know who you are, but you want to be my friend in Foursquare. By the way, Foursquare, I don't log into Foursquare as 1337wine. I have my other account. I don't get any floral, and really the only wood part I really get is the vanilla. Now on the palate, I get the wood. You get a bit of that, you know, biting into a tree aspect. You still get the dark cherries or the dark berries, okay? But not as much of a pie aspect, nothing like that. I wouldn't say there's a lot of vegetal to it, but it's there's a pepper aspect to it that there's a spiciness to it, okay? And not spicy hot, but like spices. And some of that sometimes I'll confuse with wood, but it's really more like seasoning, and you get those spices and kind of that, I wouldn't say kind of the potpourri type of thing. But definitely that type of it's very, I would say, mineral, a lot of minerality to it. Tannins are not in your face. Tannins are actually, I would say, medium minus. Like I said, the winemaker said, Anthony, that it's not an in your face zin. It's an older style. It feels a little old world because I'm getting more of the you get that earthiness, so that minerality to it. It's not a fruit bomb, so if you're looking for this massive fruit bomb or, you know, Zinfandel, you're not going to get it. It's got some spice to it. It's got a little bit, the hint of those pepper, you know, you get that white and black pepper type of thing you definitely get from Zin. It's very slight in this. This is definitely not something you're going to go, oh, I'm going to have a California Zin. They do make it in a different style. And I don't get like dustiness out of it, but if you told me I was drinking a Primitivo, I would probably be like, oh, okay, because I haven't really had a lot of those to begin with. And as the wine has opened up a little more, it's getting a little bit fruitier. You're getting more of the fruit to come through. The wood isn't as prominent. So this is definitely a wine that I could see letting sit out for a while, decant it, and it will really start to open up. And I may revisit this in a little bit after the next wine, just to kind of see what happens. But it's a wine I really like. I would definitely say, you know, if you can find this anywhere still, I would say buy it. You're probably not going to find it unless you visit the winery. So it's probably not widely available at all anywhere, but if for some reason Woot does have another sale on it, I would say get it, especially at $12 a bottle. You know, you're going to spend $60. You're going to get five bottles of wine. I'll give it a solid 87 on the Leet Winometer. Maybe I should create a little meter. Someone did say I should have scores pop up, but I've never done it. I've thought about having like a little, you know, over here on the side, having the having like the little two digit, because you know I'll never give a 100 point, you know, never give a 100 points, but having two loads of things, it goes and put a score up. 87, definitely try it. Oops. All right, so let's move on to the next wine. Of course, make sure you click links and all that. All right, we'll move on to the next wine. All right, now we're back with the third wine. Now, yes, I normally do a wine 101 at this point, and really only time I do a third wine now is for special segments. But since I can't really set the green screen up because I got the beautiful Christmas tree behind me, I figure I'll just do three wines for basically the rest of the year, any other videos I do, which this is gonna be the last regular video I'm gonna do. And then the next two are gonna be a Christmas special and going to be a, whatchamacallit, a New Year's Eve special. Now I've got some wines coming up for that. I'm trying to, now there might be one more video. I'm trying to get a Skype interview with the winery that sent me two different wines. I did tell them that if we can't coordinate it, because it's going to have to be next week, as in next week when you watch this video, it's going to have to, the interview has to happen that week pretty much so I can put something up the week before Christmas. Otherwise, I'm just going to go, you know, I told them that worst case scenario, I can use their wines for one of the wines for my Christmas special and one of the wines for my New Year's Eve special, because one of the wines is called a Christmas wine, so it makes sense to have it then, and that's why they try to get it to me. And then the other wine is a sparkling wine, so which is perfect for New Year's, and I'd like to get them done and up before before those holidays. So the Christmas special probably will be up and running, not on Christmas Eve. I'll try to have it up and running beforehand. So anyway, in the spirit of Christmas still though, I went ahead and I wanted to do this wine. Now, of course, stupid me forgot to go upstairs and get the receipt. So just look for it in the lower third, okay? But I did buy, I'll go through where I bought it. I was gonna try to do a search on it, but that's what lower thirds are for. I can do it in post. Okay, so this is the 2007 Celeste Crianza. This is from the Torres winery out of Spain. Now, Torres is huge, like big, and they're international, and they have wineries, or they have vineyards in California and vineyards in Chile, and they have a business interest in China. They're one of the biggest wineries in Europe, or they've been rated one of the best wineries in Spain and one of the best wineries in Europe. So they're not small potatoes, let's put it that way, okay? This particular wine is from the Ribera del Duero, area of Spain. That's kind of in the northern central part of Spain, along the Duero River, which becomes the Duero, in Portugal. And that's the river that all the great port wines, or all the grapes for port wines are grown. The grape varietal is Tinto Fino, which is the local name for Tempranillo. And they also, this area is also known to have some similarities with Rioja, which again is a Tempranillo, and in how they actually do the production. They use American oak, but I don't remember that they said it in here. No, it's just one of the things about it is that they do, these wines are meant to age a little bit, just like Rioja, okay? Now, one of the other things is that to know about Spanish wines is Crianza is a wine that has to age 2 years, 12 months of it has to be in oak. We'll just go through the rest. Reserva is 3 years with at least 12 months in oak, and Gran Reserva is 5 years prior to must spend 5 years aging prior to release, with 2 years being in oak. Okay. Gotta love Europe. They have all these little regulations about wine. Americans, New World, do what you want. Make a white wine out of Cabernet Sauvignon and ferment it in cedar or something. No one's gonna care. Well, no one will buy it either. All right, so I bought this at Central Market, HEB Central Market in San Antonio. I'm gonna guess this is around $20 to $25. I don't think it was any more than that, and I don't think it was really too much less than 20. It might have been 18, but like I said, the lower third will have it. So let's check it out again. The whiteboard. Probably not going to do this very often with the whiteboard because the last thing I need to do is spill wine on it. Color's a little bit deeper than the striped bass or the striped base, though you can see through it. So it's not super dark and super deep. But it's a similar color, but it's a little bit darker on the red, so it doesn't have as much brown to it. But it is clear. I like this nose a lot. It's got a good balance to it. I mean, you get red fruits, okay? And I'm sorry that I can't be a little more specific on the fruits. Okay, making sure I know the little red light's on, but there's a flashing light in the back of the camera that I keep looking for. But you're getting this, it's aged a little bit, so you're getting, and I know that the other wine's aged in bottle, but you know, this was aged a certain way that the balance has a little bit more balance for the nose. You're getting some of that red fruits, the darker red fruits. You get a little bit of creaminess or vanilla to it. Okay, that's your American oak. And you smell a little bit of wood, but it's nothing is like overpowering the other, okay, on the bouquet. I got some spices to it, you know, maybe some nutmeg, clove, that kind of stuff. Let's check it out. I love the fact that I have a thing where I can see. Really? Guess that's where the, Anyway, I just love the fact that I can see myself and what's going on. Still, the palate is very much like the nose. On the fruit, I'm gonna say it's more of a raspberry, not really a blackberry, but more of a raspberry flavor to it. So not just red fruit generically. I wouldn't really go so far as saying blueberry or blue fruit. I would stick probably with the raspberry on it, but you still get some of that. You still get that spices to it. You know, the Christmas spices. It's really, I find it really tasty. It's not a fruity. It's not a fruity wine. So I find it tasty, but it's not like it's a lot of fruit to it. It's very subtle. It's got a bit of smoothness to it. It's the tannins are not overpowering. They're like a medium tannin. Acidity is medium. Alcohol, if it's above 12.5, I would be very surprised. It's 13.5, which means it's well contained. I mean, I guess now that I know it's 13.5 and I'm kind of breathing out, I can maybe feel a little bit of the burn, but you don't really notice it. So I think it's great. And I just got this kind of whiff of smoked meat type of thing, cured meat. So definitely something you could pair with a barbecue. This is why I think Texas barbecue needs to have Texas Tempranillo. sound like a broken record a lot of times with it, but these new restaurants with Texas Tempranillo in it. It's a good wine. There's a meatiness to it also. So like I said, I think it's really balanced. I think it's an excellent wine, and it's probably one of my favorite of the three. I mean, as far as score wise, I really want to chill this a little bit and really just kind of sip on it, because I think that's going to be much better once I chill a little bit. And striped bass, we're going to check that out in just a second here. I've got to start my timer on the computer. For a score, I give it a 90. I think it's a solid wine. I think it's a really good wine. Now let's try the striped bass. The other day someone asked me about a wine key. Now this one I got from the Rioja people from a year ago at Texom. And the double hinge, yeah. I guess I still like the old school single hinge, but now that I've been using it for a while, I understand why the double hinge is become very popular, because it does make opening a bottle easier. It's just not one fluid motion, which is how I like to do it. But if anyone can find me something really good that doesn't have a serrated edge, I like a solid edge to it, because serrated edges really destroy the foil and you get a lot of particles, and I don't like that. I almost bought one at Specs today, so I bought my Somm Study Group wine at Specs, and I went over to look at their wine keys because I really want to get a better wine key. This is just fine. It's great for what I do, but I kind of want to have something a little bit better, and I couldn't find anything that was worth anything. I found one that was $20, and I looked it up online, and everybody said it was horrible. It was the worst ever. All right, so not so much on the wood. The woodiness is calming down a little bit, but now I feel a little bit of the heat. And I never looked at the alcohol on it. 14.2. I noticed the heat a little bit more than I did the other one than earlier, but. Still a good wine. Check it out. But the Celeste, probably not Celeste, it's not Italian. Celeste, good wine. If you can find it, definitely buy this. All three of the wines, you find them, get them. Like I said, this one you're probably not gonna be able to find. The Thouars, you may have to, I'm not sure if you'll be able to find it in the States. But all are recommends. All right, that's going to do it for today's show. This is probably going to be the only show I'm going to have for the next couple weeks. I'll have another posting. So I'll probably have another posting. Well, I'm going to be posting this next week. So I won't have a blog post, written blog post. And then but I'm going to be touring some Texas wineries while you're watching this. I've got some set up. For the week, and you'll be seeing those early in the next year, so pretty much January, maybe the first week of February. It kind of depends on how many actual wineries finalize everything, but I've got three solid appointments. I'm looking for a fourth. If you're seeing this now, it's a little too late probably, but I'm looking for that fourth winery. I've got a couple out there, just haven't replied back with a confirmation or not. So look for some Texas wineries coming up, and honestly, next year, I'm super stoked about the new camera, because I think it's going to really improve the look, the production value of the podcast. You know, I'm going to soapbox a little bit. You know, I've seen over the years, I've started this in 2009. I started watching, you know, video podcasts earlier than that. And let me tell you, man, most of those other ones, they don't seem like they really invested a lot of time and money into figuring out how they want their stuff to look. Now I have looked at some of my older stuff, and I use natural lighting, and it looks pretty good. And honestly, a lot of these other people, it looks like they really are sitting in their basement. They have poor lighting. It's, you know, at least sit in front of a window, all right. But you know, just all the production value that goes through. You know, they really look cheap. Okay, I've seen some other just videos for not just wines, just other stuff, and people that are trying to give you advice on how to do video production, and their audio sucks, or their lighting isn't the best. And I just kind of go, you're giving advice on that? Anyway, enough of the soapbox. Just know this, I am the best produced video wine show on the internet that's self-produced. And next year, somebody better nominate me for the best podcast in video for food and wine, because there are no wine podcasts, period, in it. And there was only like a couple video ones, and I'll be honest, I don't think they were that special at all. Well, there was one that was good, and but it's slick. It's produced. It's actually it's a radio show, actually, so it's audio, but, you know, the soapbox is done. Tell your friends, let everybody know, check it out, click the links, and we'll see everyone again next time.